in the dark and all alone, growing comfortable. Are you too scared to move or walk out of this tomb? Buried underneath the lies that you believe, safe and sound, stuck in the ground, too lost to be found. You're just asleep, and it's time to leave. Come on and rise up, take a breath, you're alive now. Can you hear the voice of Jesus calling us out from the grave like Lazarus? You're brand new, the power of death couldn't hold you. Can't you hear the voice of Jesus calling us out from the grave like Lazarus? Rise up, oh, rise up, out from the grave like Lazarus. When he said your name, the thing that filled your veins is more than blood, a kind of love that washes sin away. Now the door is open wide. Resurrected hearts. Oh, 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 he's calling us to walk out of the dark. He's giving us new resurrected hearts. Oh, come on and rise up, take a breath, you're alive now. Can't you hear the voice of Jesus calling us out from the grave like Lazarus? You're brand new, the power of death couldn't hold.
Good morning, church. How wonderful it is to see you this day. I just want to walk around and look at y'all just for a few minutes this morning, just in case. Yeah, it's all right to wave. Just in case no one has told you this, you look good today, all right? And we're glad that you're here and thankful for the gift of your presence. I'm Rusty Keene. I'm one of the pastors here. And we especially welcome those who may be joining us for worship today on our live stream, Facebook Live. We welcome you, and we are so thankful for the gift of your presence as well. As we come together today, this is a very exciting day in the life of the church. You will see about 11 active young people making their way into worship today. And we will be celebrating with them. They will be coming with Smith and with Chip later. They are in the 8:45 service being presented, and then they will come and be in this service with us. When you arrived this morning, I hope that you received a card, a Connect card, a register of attendance, and we ask that you please sign that and place that in the communion, in the offertory tray or in the box outside the basket when you leave. We thank you for doing that. I want to say to you that we have about 10% response on that. And I think that's because you don't understand how we use that. If there is a visitor and we see or we look and we remember that maybe they were sitting next to you. We may give you a call. If we didn't get the name, maybe you can help us with that name. So please, everyone, fill out the card, drop it in the box, and we would appreciate your help so much. Today is a full day. It's an active day in the life of the church. Not only do we have these three exciting worship services, but this afternoon we're all coming together for what we call a church-wide backyard cookout. And so our younger young men have secured grills and burgers and hot dogs, and they will be cooking out, depending on rain, they're going to be cooking somewhere, okay? But they will be cooking on grills, so it'll be char-grilled burgers. And in the event of rain, we will observe our rain plan and move in to the Family Life Center, to the CLC. And so I know that it is potluck desserts. We're asking for you to please cut those, have them ready to serve when you bring them, and there will be someone to receive those. Many of you, I think we have almost 200 people who have signed up for this afternoon, this evening's fellowship together. We padded that number, so just in case, if you did not register, please come on. There will be plenty. It'll be the loaves and fishes thing, and we will divide, and we will have plenty. This morning, as we come together in worship, I've already mentioned that we will celebrate and we will confirm these amazing young people. And so later in our service, we will present them by name, and we will pray for them. But I simply wanted to take this moment to say thank you, moms and dads. Thank you for the gift of your child to the church, and for our opportunity as part of the church to affirm their baptismal covenant, to walk with them on this journey, and now to be with them as they are confirmed into full membership of the church. So thank you. Thank you so much for that. Lastly, next Sunday is Baccalaureate Sunday, where we will be celebrating those who have been with us a little longer, our high school graduating seniors. Please remember that in the gathering room, there is a display that is set up that has all of their names. We have cards. We have baskets beside their names so that you can write them a note, leave them a gift, whatever the Spirit might call you to do. But that is set up today in the gathering room. So please, please take the time to go by and check that out. Without anything else, I simply invite us to breathe, to pause, to give thanks for God, and to breathe the Holy Spirit. Would you pray with me, dear friends? O Lord, our God, come now through the gift of your Holy Spirit. Fall upon us. Be closer to us than the breath that we breathe, so that when we leave this place, surely we will know that we have been in the presence of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It's in his name that we offer these prayers. Amen and amen. And now, as our band, our team leads us, we invite you to greet each other. Let's stand. And let's sing and let's greet each other in a spirit of Christ love.
Good morning, everyone. Let's worship.
Are you past the point of weary? Is your burden weighing heavy? Is it all too much to carry? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Do you feel that empty feeling? 'Cause shame's done all its healing, and you're desperate for some healing. Let me tell you about my Jesus. Till the past to disappear. Oh, let me tell you about my Jesus and all the wrong turns that you would go and undo if you could. Wouldn't work it all for your good. Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about to Calvary and pay the price for all my guilty, and who would care that much about me? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Oh,
he makes a way where there ain't no way, rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save.
Darkness.
you so much. Friends, you may be seated. So I just received some great news, and that is that we've had to bring in some more chairs. That's celebratory. Let's give thanks to God for that. There are a few back in this area, and if you see someone coming in, squeeze in. Get close to each other so that there is room for all. There's a place for everyone at First United Methodist Church. Now, that's the good news. The second news is Smith's not here yet. So we're going to expand this a little bit. He will be coming. So Rakesha, I'm going to lead us in a time of prayer. And then if Smith is not back, could you be prepared? Maybe just you and Tony to come and bless us or something? Oh, absolutely. Sure you can. Sure you can. Okay. Well, I want to begin this morning. I hope you notice 11 fabulous young people who are gathered here in worship today. We're so proud of you, and we're so thankful for you. And we're thankful that you are a part of the life of this church. I've only been here about 9 months, but I've been watching you, and I've had the opportunity to attend some of your events at your school, and just to hear of your great love for Jesus Christ, and I thank you. I thank you for that. We're proud of you. We love you very much. We pray God's richest blessings upon you today. At this time, I also want to ask you, where has God shown up in your everyday, ordinary life? So if you are here today, our former bishop, Bishop Swanson, called these moments glory sightings. Has God shown up in your everyday, ordinary life this week? And if so, does anyone want to give a witness to that? And you're looking at me like, I'm not about to do that, okay? All right, okay. Let me just ask it this way. If God has showed up in your everyday, ordinary life this week, would you raise your hand? Absolutely. God shows up where we are. Let's also take this time to acknowledge and to realize that in all of our lives, there are times of need. There are times when we are hurt. There are times when we are broken. There are times when we feel alone. There are times when we are sick, when we have loved ones who are not well. There are times when we grieve. There are times when maybe we desire to be in worship, but circumstances prevent us from being here. And so we remember those today who would like to join us in worship, but for whatever the reason, they have been unable to come. So I simply invite us to enter into a time of prayer. I'll be silent for a moment. I'll ask you in your private, personal space to offer your prayers to God. Would you pray with me, and then I'll lead us together. Let's pray. Most gracious and holy Lord Jesus, as we come into this space and Lord, as we hear the flowing water, we are reminded of our own baptism. We are reminded of that time in our lives where we passed through the waters. The waters of baptism were either poured upon us or sprinkled upon us or maybe we were immersed. God, whatever the method, you were there, working in our lives and preparing us to follow you. We thank you, God, for the gift of your church. We thank you for the gift of these confirmands and for this journey that they have taken these last several months. We pray, God, that your hand will always be upon them, giving them peace and guiding their next steps. God, we also come and we lift in our hearts those places that so much need to feel your healing. Those places, God, where we need to know that you are right beside us. Oh God, forgive us when we have failed to be who you've called us to be. God, through that forgiveness, may we know that each and every day is a new step in the journey with you. Thank you, God, for your church, for all who are gathered here. Hear now the prayers of your people. We offer them in the precious and holy name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. And young Smith has arrived.
I'm going to stay dressed up, but that's all right.
That's good.
Won't hurt anybody. We have our confirmation class with us here today, and we have the joy of having them offer some of our readings for us. So I'm going to invite those representatives up from the class who will lead us in our prayers before our scriptures and then our first two scripture readings.
Let us pray. Lord, as we listen to your holy word, open our hearts to the power of your Spirit. Call us out of the darkness and lead us into your marvelous light. Amen.
In you, O Lord, I seek refuge. Do not let me ever be put to shame. In your righteousness, deliver me. Incline your ear to me. Rescue me speedily. Be a rock of my refuge for me, a strong fortress to save me. You are indeed my rock, my fortress. For your name's sake, lead me and guide me. Take me out of the net that is hidden for me. For you are my refuge. Into your hand I commit spirit. You are my redeemed, O Lord, faithful God. My times are in your hand. Deliver me from the hand of my enemies and prosecutors. Let your face shine upon your servant. Save me in your steadfast love.
Like newborn infants long for pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow into salvation, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. Come to him, a living stone, though rejected by mortals, yet chosen and precious in God's sight. Like living stones, let yourselves be built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For it stands in the Scriptures, see, I am laying in a Zion a stone, a cornerstone chosen and precious, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. To you who believes, he is precious, but for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the very head of the corner, and a stone that makes them stumble, and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the word, as they were destined to do. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, in order that you may proclaim the mighty acts of him who called you out of the darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are a God's people. Once you have not received mercy, but now you have received mercy.
The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I invite you to stand with me as we hear the word from the gospel. This is from John 14, beginning with verse 1. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and we will be satisfied. Jesus said to him, Have I been with you all this time, Philip, and you still do not know me? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, Show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. Believe me, that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me. But if you do not, then believe me because of the works themselves. Very truly, I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and in fact will do greater works than these, because I am going to the Father. I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If in my name you ask me for anything, I will do it. The gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Pray with me. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, our rock, O Lord, and our Redeemer. Amen. Believe in God, Jesus says. Believe also in me. That, of course, is one of the basic things that we say as Christians. We believe in God. In a little while, we'll join in the Apostles' Creed together, and we'll say that we believe in God the Father and God the Son, and we believe in God the Holy Spirit. But as soon as we start talking about belief, difficult questions arise. What about God is it that I believe? Who is the God that we believe in? Have I believed in the right ways? Have I believed strongly enough? What do I do if I'm struggling to believe? What if I believe and it doesn't seem to be making any difference in my life? What about my actions? Is belief just something in your head and your heart, or does it have some kind of effect on the way that we live? All of those are good questions. I notice in John 14 that we see Jesus' disciples beginning to ask some questions that are like that. How can we know the way, asks Thomas. Lord, show us the Father, Philip adds, which is a question that's dressed up as a request. Jesus accepts those questions. Jesus seems to like questions. And again points to the need for us to believe. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me. But if you do not, then believe me because of the works themselves. Believe because of what he's doing. Jesus' answer points back to a previous statement that he's made in between Thomas's question and Philip's statement, which is really kind of a question. Jesus has told them, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. With those words, Jesus is telling us something essential about what it is to believe itself. We believe in Jesus because we believe through Jesus, the way, the truth, and the life. We believe in Jesus because Jesus is in us and we are in him. We believe in Jesus because we believe through Jesus. Now let me take y'all back to elementary school, okay? At some point, for some of you, this was longer ago than others, but you probably all remember this. At some point, you learned about the subject and the predicate of a sentence. Does that sound familiar? Y'all didn't get a lot of grammar lessons in confirmation, but here, you get a grammar lesson, right? So subject and the predicate of a sentence. Now, the subject is, you know, who's doing the sentence, right? Then the predicate tells us what the subject is doing, or, you know, describes the subject in some way. So the subject is a noun or a pronoun, and then the predicate will have a verb and some modifiers, and then perhaps some objects, the thing or the person that the action is being done to. Simple enough. When it comes to belief, we often put God in the predicate of the sentence. God is the object of our sentences. When we say something like, believe in God, or believe God, and all that's well and good, God is indeed the object of our belief. But in this passage, Jesus reminds us that when it comes to belief, God is also the subject of our sentences, whether he stated in the subject or not. I am the way and the truth and the life. Belief is God's work in us, to us, through us. God is the one performing the action. We become God's people because of what God is doing in us and to us and through us. All of this is to say that we do not save ourselves. Belief is not a matter simply of us in our own power believing hard enough or believing in the right ways or in any way of us saving ourselves. Belief is a response. Belief is a response to a God who has created us, who comes for us in Jesus and through the Holy Spirit, who rescues us, who restores us, and makes us new. Jesus, with the Father and the sentence, is not only the object of our belief, the one that we believe in, but is the subject as well. It is Jesus, in a sense, who is believing in us. And for our confirmands who come today to profess their faith in Jesus, what we celebrate is not that we're going through this particular rite, or that they have scored high enough, or that they've done all their homework, because I know you haven't, but I know you will by the end of it all. What we celebrate is that God is at work in them. When it comes for the moment of confirmation, Rusty lays hands on them, we'll say, the Holy Spirit work within you, that being born of water and the Spirit, you may be a faithful disciple of Jesus. We pray and recognize and celebrate that it is God at work in you. Jesus is the subject of our sentences. We believe in him and through him. He is the way and the truth and the life. He is at once the one that we believe in and the way that we come to believe and the one who sustains that belief and makes us live. And friends, this is the good news of the gospel for us today. I pray that this would be so. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Today we get to celebrate that these young people have come to place their faith in Christ, and we join them in celebrating the work of God in their lives. And we all, you all, have the opportunity not only to see them, but to say that you will continue to walk with them and support them in their Christian life. And so, allow me to introduce the class for you. As I read their names, they're going to stand and remain standing, and y'all are going to kind of face outward so that everyone can see you, all right? So just, actually, we're kind of more in a circle. So just stand up where you are and kind of turn and wave and let them know that you're here, okay? I invite you to stand as I call your name. This year's confirmation class, we have Miller Jane Addison, James Ashley Atkinson, Vivian Stewart Gouger, Andrew Knox Garner, Bryson Franklin Hodges, Morgan Rose Letty, Addie Mae McCoy, Lillian Shelton Pace, Ann Bailey Thomas, Margaret Tyndall Wise. We also have Mary Tandler Perry, who will be being confirmed at a later date. And then we've been blessed to have two participants from other churches who have accompanied this class and done everything with them the entire way. They belong to other churches, but they've been a part of this family. And so we've had Elizabeth Edwards, and here with us today, accompanying her friends, Mary Parker McClellan. And they've been a terrific reminder to them and to me that the faith that we hold in our baptism and the faith that we hold in Christ is a faith that we share with our friends across the community and other churches and with the communion of the saints all around the world. And so we celebrate this confirmation class together. So friends, oh yeah, give them a hand clap. There you go. And so church, I ask you, and you can follow the words that you'll see on the screens, will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and life and include these persons now before you in your care? With God's help, We will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround these persons with a community of love and forgiveness, that they may grow in their trust of God and be found faithful in their service to others. We will pray for them that they may be true disciples who walk in the way that leads to life. Amen. And now I invite you all to stand as we profess our faith in Christ together. Let us join in professing the Christian faith as contained in the scriptures of the Old and New Testaments. Do you believe in God the Father? I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe in Jesus Christ? I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. And do you believe in the Holy Spirit? I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Y'all may be seated.
Dear friends, Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, all who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And now hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, and that proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. Would you look at the neighbor who is sitting next to you and simply offer these words, "The peace of Christ be with you." And now, friends, we have an opportunity to continue responding to God's word by now giving our tithes, God's tithes, and our offering to the church. If our ushers would please come as we have a morning offering.
I'm so concerned with what I look like from the outside. Will I blossom into what you hoped I'll be? Yet you're so patient just to help me see that blooms come from a deeper seed that you've planted in me. Sometimes it's hard to grow and everybody's watching. To have your heart pruned by the one who knows best. And though I'm barren cold, I know my season's coming, and I'll spring up in your endless faithfulness. With my roots deep in you, I'll grow the branch that bears the fruit. And though I'm small, I'll still be standing in the storm. 'Cause I am planted by
water streams of living water, and I'll grow up strong and beautiful, all for your splendor, Lord. So with my arms stretched out, I'm swaying to your heartbeat. I'm growing with the sound of your voice calling. You're bringing out the beauty that you have put in me, for your joy and for your glory falling. That bears the fruit, and though I'm small, I'll still be standing in the storm. 'Cause I am planted by the river, by your streams of living water, and I'll grow up strong and beautiful, all for your splendor, because I am planted by the river, by your streams of living water. And I'll grow up strong and beautiful, all for your splendor, Lord.
Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, brought us to a land flowing with milk and honey, and set before us the way of life. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. By your great mercy, we have been born anew to a living hope through the resurrection of your Son from the dead, and into an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading. Once we were no people, but now we are your people, declaring your wonderful deeds in Christ, who called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." On the day you raised him from the dead, He was recognized by his disciples in the breaking of the bread. And in the power of your Holy Spirit, your church has continued in the breaking of bread and the sharing of the cup. And so, in remembrance with these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as the confidence of the children of God, let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. The bread that we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. And the cup over which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ. Those who are helping me to serve would come forward. Allow me to give you some instructions. We'll have two stations, one on either side of the table. Y'all can come on. We'll have two stations, one on either side of the table. And you can simply come as you feel led and get in either line to receive the bread and to receive the cup. And then our kneelers all around the room are open for you to go and pray. If you'd like for someone to pray with you, Rusty will be in this corner over here, and he would love to accompany you in prayer if you'd like to spend some time doing that. Know that this is a table that is opened to the world through Christ. And those who believe in Christ and wish to follow him are welcome to receive at this table. If you perhaps have come today and you haven't yet received the gift of baptism, and you feel a call to be at this table, know that Christ is also calling you to take that next step in your faith, to receive baptism and confirmation with it, and to profess your faith in Christ with the church. And if that's you, Rusty or I would love to talk to you after the service. Friends, the table is prepared. Come at Christ's invitation.
The same. prodigal return.
Yesterday's gone, and all my sins are
Let's pray together. Oh God, we thank you for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. We pray that we would go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to share your love with the world that needs to receive it. We pray that Christ would be in us, in our believing and in our doing and in our living every step of the way. In his name we pray. Amen. Friends, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all and go with you. Amen. Go in peace.
He's calling us to walk out of the dark. He's giving us the resurrected heart. Oh, he's calling us to walk.